The most visually mind-blowing websites in the world all seem to follow a similar pattern. They use 3D animations that bring the content to life when the page is scrolled. A website like mav.farm doesn't have a scroll bar, but instead animates a whole 3D world as you scroll through the page. This may look impossibly difficult, but in today's video, you'll learn how to create your own 3D animations with JavaScript using 3JS. By the end of this video, you will have built a personal portfolio website that's so impressive it's guaranteed to get you a job or your money back. And you might be shocked at how easy it really is when you understand a few concepts related to cameras, lighting, and geometry. This tutorial is beginner friendly, and I'll assume you're brand new to 3JS and 3D graphics in general. What we'll build today is a website that uses CSS Grid for its main content and has a 3D animated background that changes the camera perspective as the user scrolls down. Looking closer, we have an avatar image that is actually a 3D cube that rotates as we scroll down. Then we have a big 3D ring that rotates continuously. You'll also notice a bunch of 3D stars in the background that change their position as the camera moves. And at the bottom, we have a rotating moon animation. It doesn't look perfect, but it's about as realistic as the official moon landings. The inspiration for this video came from atelier.net, which is a great example of an amazing website that uses both CSS Grid and 3JS. But what is 3JS exactly? Well, basically, it's just a library for drawing 3D graphics in the browser with JavaScript and WebGL. In any 3D scene, whether it's on the web, a movie, or video game, you have a bunch of geometries or shapes that get styled with textures, which might be done with math or just a regular raster image. A scene will also have one or more lights to make the shapes visible. And finally, there needs to be a camera to give the end user perspective on the screen. Now when animation comes into play, we can set up an infinite loop or some other trigger like the scroll bar to change the properties on these objects to animate them. 3JS makes this process very developer friendly, as you'll see throughout the video. But I would like to point out that it's not really a tool for modeling or drawing complex 3D shapes. For that, we have tools like Blender, and you can actually import your Blender models directly into 3JS to use them on the web. Now, before we jump into the code, make sure to like and subscribe, then open up VS Code to an empty directory and open up a terminal session. We'll build this project with plain old vanilla JS, and you can find the source code on GitHub or Fireship.io. First, we need to initialize a project that can handle dependencies, and to do that, we'll use a tool called Vite. Create a new project by running npm init vitejs/app. Running this command will give us the option to select vanilla.js, which will initialize a new project with a main.js file and a package.json where we can install dependencies. From there, install 3JS by running npm install 3. And after that's done, we'll run the npm run dev command to serve our app locally. That should serve the app on localhost 3000, but then let's go into the style CSS and main.js file and delete all the boilerplate code. If you look at my project files, you'll notice that I have a few images here. You can grab these images from the GitHub repo. However, I would encourage you to use your own images for this project. I'll be explaining the concepts in detail so you can take these ideas and build your own awesome portfolio. The first thing we'll do is go into the index.html file and add a canvas to the body, which will be the element that shows the actual 3JS scene. Notice how it comes before the main.js script and has an ID of background. From there, we'll go into our style sheet and give the canvas fixed positioning and pin it to the top left corner of the screen, which will allow it to serve as a background, and eventually we will overlay other HTML elements on top of it. From there, we'll go into our main.js file, and the first thing we'll do is import the 3JS library. To start things off, you'll always need three objects: a scene, a camera, and a renderer. The scene is like a container that holds all of your objects, cameras, and lights. Now, in order to look at things inside the scene, we need a camera. There are multiple different camera types in 3JS, but the most common one you'll come across is the perspective camera, which is designed to mimic what human eyeballs would see. The first argument is field of view, which is the amount of the world that's visible based on a full 360 degrees. The second argument is the aspect ratio, which is based off of the user's browser window, and we can calculate it by dividing the window's inner width by the inner height. Then the last two arguments are for the view frustum to control which objects are visible relative to the camera itself. Since we have 0.01 and 1000 here, we can see pretty much everything from the camera lens. Now that we have a camera, we need a renderer to render out the actual graphics to the scene. The renderer needs to know which DOM element to use, which will be the canvas with an ID of background. Once instantiated, we can use the renderer to set the pixel ratio to the window device pixel ratio and also make it a full screen canvas by setting the renderer size to the window size. Now currently, our camera is positioned in the middle of the scene, so what I'll do next is move it along the Z-axis, and that'll give us a better perspective when we start adding shapes. Now the final thing we'll do is call the renderer's render method, passing it the scene and the camera as arguments. And if we open it up in the browser, we should just have a blank screen at this point. So the next thing we'll do is add an object to it. There are three basic steps when creating an object. First, you need a geometry or a set of vectors that define the object itself. 3JS has a bunch of built-in geometries like box, sphere, cone, cylinder, and so on. I'll go ahead and create a new torus geometry, which is like a big 3D ring. Now that we have a geometry, we need to define a material to give it color or some kind of texture. Think of a material as wrapping paper for a geometry. There are many different kinds of materials built into 3JS for different uses that will give you different results. And you can even write your own custom shaders with WebGL to use as a material, but that's beyond the scope of this video. Now, most materials rely on a light source to bounce off of them, but in this case, we'll use a basic material which requires no light source. It has a bunch of parameters for customization, like a color, and we'll also set wireframe to true to get a better look at its actual geometry. The third step is to create a mesh by combining the geometry with the material, and that's the actual thing that we want to add to the scene, which we do by calling scene.add. Now, to actually see it, we need to re-render the screen by calling the same render method again. You don't want to have to call the render method over and over again in your code, so a better approach here is to set up a recursive function that gives us an infinite loop that calls the render method automatically. We have a function named animate that calls request animation frame in the browser, which is a mechanism that tells the browser that you want to perform an animation. Now, whenever the browser repaints the screen, it will call your render method to update the UI. You can think of this as a game loop if you've ever done game development. Go ahead and call the animate function, then open up the browser, and you should see the torus shape. Currently, the torus is not doing anything, so let's go back into our animation loop and change that. Every shape that we create has different properties like rotation, position, and scale. And if we change its properties inside the loop, the shape will animate. In this case, we'll update the rotation along the x-axis by 0.01 for every animation frame, and we'll do the same thing for the y and z-axis as well. Back in the browser, you should now see the torus animated in an infinite loop. So that's pretty cool, but now I want to introduce the concept of lighting because that's what makes your 3D objects really come to life. Going back to our material object, we'll change it from mesh basic material to mesh standard material, which is a material that will react to light bouncing off of it. Let's also remove the wireframe property, then go back to the browser, and you'll notice that we have a black screen again. That's because there's nothing lighting this object up. There are many different types of lighting to choose from in 3JS, but an easy one to get started with is a point light, which emits light in all directions as if you added a light bulb to the scene. We'll go ahead and instantiate a new point light with a color of white. And by the way, if you're wondering what this 0x is, that is a hexadecimal literal. Whenever you write 0x in JavaScript and most other programming languages, it means you're working with a hexadecimal value instead of a regular number type. That's just a random good thing to know, but now back to our light. We'll go ahead and position it to move it away from the center, setting its X, Y, and Z values to 5. Make sure to add it to the scene like any other object, then let's check it out in the browser. The light is actually positioned inside of the torus, so it lights up the inside part of the ring. If we go back to our code and update the values to 20, it moves the light farther away and lights up a larger area of the ring. That's cool when you want to focus on a specific point, but in some cases you might want lighting across the entire scene, in which case you can instantiate an ambient light. An ambient light is more like a floodlight in the room and will light up everything in the scene equally. Notice how we can see the entire shape of the ring at this point. Now, working with lights and shapes can be very confusing, but luckily 3JS has a couple of helpers that can make our life much easier. The first one is the light helper, which will show us the position of a point light. Instantiate the helper, then pass the point light as an argument and add it to the scene. Then notice how that added a little wireframe that shows the position and direction of the light source. Another thing that's very helpful is the grid helper, which draws a two-dimensional grid along the scene. When we add a grid helper to the scene and then try to view it in the browser, you'll notice that we just get a little gray line here. That's because our current perspective is perfectly level with the grid. We can easily make the scene more interactive by adding orbit controls to it, which will allow us to move around the scene using our mouse. To do that, we'll first need to import the orbit controls class from the 3JS examples namespace. Once that's done, we can then instantiate the orbit controls class and pass it the camera and the renderer DOM element as arguments. What this will do is listen to DOM events on the mouse and update the camera position accordingly. We then need to call controls.update in the animation loop to make sure that the changes are reflected in the UI. At this point, you should be able to go into the browser and pan around with your mouse to see the full nature of the grid. Now that we have some helpers in place, I want to show you how you can use 3JS math helpers to randomly generate a large number of objects in the scene. In this case, we'll populate outer space with a bunch of randomly generated stars. To handle that, we'll create a function called addStar. Inside the function, we'll start by instantiating a sphere geometry where each sphere has a radius of 0.25. We'll then create a standard material and join them together as a mesh. That's easy enough, but the tricky part here is how do we randomly position these stars throughout the scene? What we need to do is randomly generate an X, Y, and Z position value for each star. We can do that by filling an array with three values, then we'll map each value to the 3JS random float spread function, which is just a helper function that randomly generates a number between negative and positive 100. We can then take those random numbers and set the position of the star, and finally add it to the scene. Now it's just a matter of deciding how many stars we want to add to the scene. For that, I'll create an array of 200 values, then for each value, call the addStar function. Back in the browser, our scene should be populated with 200 randomly positioned stars. That looks pretty cool, but we could make this even better by adding a background to outer space. In many cases, you'll need to load images and textures into your scene. In this example, we'll load a simple JPEG image using the 3JS texture loader. It's worth noting that you can also pass a callback function here to be notified when the image is done loading. That's useful if you want to show a loading bar if your scene relies on a lot of static assets. In any case, we can set the image as the scene background by simply updating that property. And now the landscape for our scene is starting to look much more interesting. We can also add textures to individual materials, which is a big complex topic known as texture mapping. Basically, texture mapping is the process of taking two-dimensional pixels and mapping them to a three-dimensional geometry. To demonstrate a texture map, I'll go ahead and use the texture loader to load another image, then create a mesh that contains a box geometry and a basic material. The only interesting thing here is that we'll define the map property on the material as the texture. Let's go ahead and add that object to the scene, and now when we open the browser, we have a 3D cube with the image mapped to all six sides of it. That's pretty simple, but we can also combine multiple maps to create more interesting objects like we'll do for our moon. Let's create a new mesh named Moon that has a sphere with a radius of 3 and a mesh standard material. Now, just like the previous example, we'll load a texture of the moon JPEG and add that as the map property. That'll take the image and wrap it around the sphere. But another cool thing we can do here is give it the appearance of having some depth by adding a normal map to it. As you can see here, I have this purple image, which will create the appearance of dents and bumps and allow light to bounce off of them to create an appearance of an object that's not perfectly uniform. A normal map can make an object feel much more realistic with very little effort. Notice how the surface of the moon is no longer smooth, creating the illusion of craters and mountains. At this point, we have an animated scene, but I want to also show you how to animate it when the user scrolls. But before we can do that, we first need to add some markup to the page. In the index.html file, I'm adding a bunch of markup for the header and main content of the web page. The important point here is that the content takes up a lot of vertical space, allowing the main body of the website to be scrolled. You'll also want to make sure that the root parent element has a position of absolute. In my case, that's the main element, so make sure that's updated in your CSS. Now back in the JavaScript, I'm going to first reposition the moon to be further down the z-axis, because that's the direction that we'll be scrolling in. And it's worth noting that when working with many properties in 3JS, you can either assign them using the equal sign, or you can use a setter function like set x in this case. They both do the same thing, so it's just a matter of preference. From there, let's define a function called move camera, and then assign that function as the event handler for the document body on scroll event. That will fire this function every time the user scrolls. Now, inside the function body, the first thing we need to do is calculate where the user is currently scrolled to. One way to do that is to call the document body get bounding client rect function. That will give us the dimensions of the viewport, and the top property will show us exactly how far we are from the top of the web page. From there, we can start changing properties on our 3D objects whenever this function is called. We'll go ahead and rotate the moon and also the avatar, but the most important thing here is changing the position of the actual camera itself. The top value will always be negative, so I'm going to multiply it by a negative number. You'll likely want to play around with these numbers to get the animation you're going for. Now, the final thing I want to show you is how I use CSS Grid to make this layout really easy to build. I'm not going to go through every line of CSS, but I'll just show you the important things here. If we go to the main element, which is the main parent in the HTML, you'll notice that I have it set as display grid. Then I have grid template columns to repeat 12 columns at one fractional unit. Basically, that gives us 12 equally sized columns on which we can position all of the children. Now, if we go down to a child element, like a section, we can add the grid column property and set it to start at the second column and end at the eighth column. Or in the header, we can start at the second column and then have it span across 5 columns. The bottom line here is that it's very easy to position DOM elements to align with the 3D stuff going on in the background. I'm gonna go ahead and wrap things up there. If this video helped you, please like, subscribe, and share, and consider becoming a pro member at Fireship.io to support the channel and get even more content. Thanks for watching, and I will see you in the next one.